morning, everybody. Welcome. Good to see you all again. Go ahead and stand with me. Every service, we begin it with a scripture reading together. So today's scripture is Psalm 72, verses 18 and 19. Let's read this together. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things. Blessed be his glorious name forever. May the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. So let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we love you. We are so grateful to get together with other people who love you, Lord, for an opportunity to lift up your name, to hear your word from the scriptures. And God, I just pray that you would pour your light and your love and your truth into us today as we open our hearts to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship. Closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Good morning. You may be seated. Welcome to this gathering of Bayside Baptist. My name is John. I'm pastor here, and Christ Jesus calls us together this morning in the faith and fellowship of the gospel. And as part of our worship, we want to confess our faith together. If you look to the screen, the question this morning is, how does the Holy Spirit help us? How does the Holy Spirit help us? Say this with me. The Holy Spirit convicts us of our sin, comforts us, guides us, gives us spiritual gifts and the desire to obey God. And he enables us to pray and to understand God's word. Ephesians 6 says, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Praying for all of our church family is what that is saying to us. So let's bow our heads and pray. Holy Spirit, grow your love, your joy, your peace in us. Shine your light on the secret sins of our hearts that we may see them, be broken by them, and confess them, knowing that because of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, we are cleansed, and we are no longer enslaved to them. Equip us for the tasks that are too large for us. Equip us for every task that you would have us to do. Make us glad in what delights you. Intercede for us. Open our eyes to rightly understand your word of truth, that we would not make it say what we want it to say, but we would listen to what you have to say to us, and that we would respond in faith and repentance and obedience, that we would respond with joy. Do this even now as we worship. In your holy name I pray. Amen. So we come together in the faith and the fellowship of the gospel, and this morning we will celebrate our faith with the Lord's Supper after the next two songs. But we also come together for the mission of the gospel. And this morning, Gene's going to come and share with us from our Kairos Prison Ministry. So listen to Gene.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody this morning. I have the privilege of being on a team of guys that goes into a prison. Thank you so much. He knows. Anyhow, it's pretty awesome, isn't it? A prison ministry called Kairos. We go into a level 5 facility and share God's love. We do that every month, but twice a year we go in there for a 4-day retreat where we meet a group of new guys to share his love. And that's going to happen at the end of October. So the church has allowed me to come up here and talk a little bit about Kairos, to kind of begin to prepare your hearts and how you can help us when we go to the end of the month. I'm going to ask you at sometime in October if you would pray for us, so be looking out for that. I'm also going to ask you possibly to help with some cookies, because that's a big part of our ministry. I think I've mentioned that before. But I want to tell you what a blessing the ministry is. So we've been doing this for a while now, and there's a young man in that prison. His name is Hector. Some of you know about Hector because the word is starting to spread. I've never seen a young man like this that reaches out to so many people outside of prison to be a blessing. This young man, this is how creative he is. When he was going to the chow hall, on his way back to his room, his cell, in the evenings, would take an apple, an orange, a pear, whatever, grab a handful of dirt, throw it in some kind of container, I never saw the container, and plant this fruit. It began to grow. It began to sprout. And he started a little tree garden. He had everything on a cart where during the day he would take it out in sunlight, and in the evening he'd bring it back in so that it would be protected. Somewhere he found out about a teacher that was teaching some special needs children, and he sent like 10 of those saplings to those 12-year-old girls that were special needs. Well, that wasn't enough for him, so he thought that because he knew some folks, some of us on the team, that he wanted to bless us. So he wrapped up some saplings and mailed them. I received 3 apple trees, some orange trees, a date palm tree. Anyhow, I get this stuff in an envelope all wrapped up, and I'm thinking, oh boy, my job to keep it alive, and I don't know how to do that. So guess what I did? I called Josh Sheik, and I said, hey, Josh. No, anyhow, I told Leslie, and Leslie reached out to Josh. Out of all he sent, we have an orange tree that's still alive. As that tree begins to grow, the plan is we're going to plant it out there somewhere, and Hector's garden is going to begin. And so life from prison is going to begin at Bayside Baptist Church, because that young man had the foresight to want to bless people with something as simple as fruit trees, which I think is amazing. Another way that this church supports us, at this facility, there are juveniles. What it is to be a juvenile in prison is they have committed a crime that was, they were sentenced as an adult, which means they begin their prison term as a teenager. While they're a teenager, they are separated from the general population. They have their own building, they have their own meals, they're totally separate. We found out about these guys, and we decided that while we were there, we thought it was important to reach out to them for a number of reasons. One, on their 18th birthday, they moved to general population. Imagine that, how lonely that's going to be. So what we wanted to do was introduce ourselves to them as a Kairos team, but also encourage them to be a part of the Kairos ministry once they transfer over to general population, so that they will have a network of guys in the prison that will look out for them and take care of them. Well, 2 weeks ago, we went up there for a 2-day retreat, and Jeremy and I got to go in and visit with these juveniles, 3 of them, 17 years old. And when we go in, we try to just share God's word with them. Nothing elaborate, just, and Jessica, bless her heart, Jessica gave me some material from our vacation Bible school that I could take in there and share with them. It was amazing. These 3 young men sat around the table. We were able to open the Bible, and I asked one of them, I said, hey, man, do you have a Bible? Yeah, and he goes and gets it. Guess what? It was large print. It was amazing. Anyhow, so I opened the Bible, and I'm like, hey, and I'm turning to the passage in Matthew, and I see a marker in the Bible, and I'm like, why is there a marker in your Bible? And he said, in the front of that Bible, there's a Bible reading plan that if you read a chapter from the Old Testament, a New Testament, and a Psalm every day in a year, you can read the Bible through. And I said, you're doing that? And he said, yes. That was so inspiring to me. I know he's going to be in there for a while. Don't know how long, don't care. But the fact that he's chosen to pick up his Bible and read it, so when we go back, we can have topics of conversation on God's word with him. And who knows, possibly lead him to the Lord before he even turns 18, because he's got another year. But man, you see how God's at work, even in the midst of a dark place like prison, and then he allows people like me to go in there and see what he's doing. What a blessing he is, our God is, and how he's reaching out through all kind of resources to touch lives for Jesus. Let's pray. Oh, our Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to you that we get to see you at work. I'm grateful to be a part of Bayside Baptist Church that believes in ministries and missions, Lord. It's not just about the gospel here, but it reaches all over the world, and even in a dark place like Sussex 2 State Prison. And I thank you, Father, for the opportunities that we have as a Kairos team to go in there and see you at work, see you moving in the lives of men to change their lives, Lord, to take them from where they are right now to possibly even a saving knowledge of your Son and our Savior. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for your sacrifice for us, Lord. And I ask, Lord, that you would continue to watch over this ministry and that you would continue to use everybody in this congregation to spread your love and your gospel. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you for the time.
Go ahead and stand with me as we continue our time of worship. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains. Yes, sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I go by as he wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Precious blood shall never lose its power till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Sin no more. And since by faith I saw the stream thy flowing womb supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till die, and shall be till I die. Yes, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. Has been my theme and shall be till I die. Jesus, we thank you for that love, that redeeming love. That love that came and found us first. God, because you love us. So as we're sitting here and we're singing these songs this morning, Lord, it's not just words coming out of our mouths. that mean nothing, God, but it's the gratefulness in our hearts. We feel your love this morning, Lord. We know it's here. Filling this place, filling our hearts. And Lord, we just take a quiet moment here. The world is always pressing at us with the latest news and the headlines and the next thing we have to get to. But God, you wait right there in the stillness to fill us with that redeeming love. So just take a moment, close your eyes. Forget about everything else you have to do today. For all of you NFL fans, that might be a little hard. But God, we open our hearts right now. Let's just speak in the stillness. We love you, Lord. We love you. The Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain here. Let's sing that again from the top. And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. 'Cause Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. The throne I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. And raise this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Jesus.
Ushers will come forward. We'll pray in just a moment. This morning we take the Lord's Supper together. This is a time when we remember that Jesus willingly gave his life in our place to deliver us from the power and the penalty of sin, to bring us back to God. And by his death in our place, he alone redeems us from death and the power of sin. And he brings forgiveness of our sins. He brings a right relationship with God and everlasting life with God and his kingdom. He does this for us as individuals. He does this for us as a people. God makes us alive with Christ, and then he calls us together as the church. And so when we take the Lord's Supper, we say the church covenant together to remind us that we are God's people and we follow Christ together. So look to the screen and say this with me this morning. We are Bayside Baptist Church, a community of people centered around Jesus. We have received Jesus alone for salvation as he is offered to us in the gospel. We have professed our faith in Jesus through baptism in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We wholeheartedly and joyfully commit to follow Christ as one body in him. So the deacons will pass out the bread and this cup, and we'll take these together. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, we invite you to join us today as we express our faith in Jesus. If you are not a believer, we are glad you're here. One of you guys is going to have to come on stage. If you're not a believer in Jesus, we're glad you're here and want you here. Ask questions, observe. I hope you see the power of the gospel changing our lives, but you need to know this bread, this cup will not save you. It will not make you more spiritual. It will not bring you closer to God. This is just bread and juice. But this bread and this juice point us to what Christ has done to win salvation for us. And so by receiving this bread and this cup, we proclaim our faith in Christ. The deacons will continue to pass out the bread and the cup. As they do, let's pray. Almighty God, unto you all hearts are open, all desires are known. There are no secrets hidden from you. We ask that you would cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, that we might worthily magnify your holy name through Christ Jesus our Lord. That you would wash clean our thoughts and ideas, our loves and desires, our choices and decisions, even our worship, Lord. Purify us and make us whole through Jesus Christ. You have saved us, and we thank you. We ask that you would continue the process of sanctification, making us whole, mature, complete, until the day that we awaken in your kingdom. In your holy name I pray. So Christ, he died for sins. He made full atonement. He covered the debt that our sins created. We are forgiven and we have the promise of eternal life. This bread, this cup, remind us that we now have a place at the Father's table in his kingdom because of Christ Jesus. So at the Last Supper, Jesus took bread, he broke it, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." That same night, Jesus took the cup, he blessed it, he said, "Take, drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this every time you drink it in remembrance of me." For every time we eat this bread, we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. As Christ, he's called us together as a church, not just for worship, but to build a community of believers, to build relationships with one another. And one of the ways we build this community, one of the ways that we take responsibility for one another, is we pray for one another and we pray with one another. And so every week we have a prayer. You can pick up prayer cards in the church welcome center. We email this out. I think it's on Facebook or somewhere on the internet webpage. But this is a way that we can pray together throughout the week, even when we're not gathered. So bow your heads as we pray for our church family this morning. God, we praise you as Lord over all. Everything in the universe belongs to you. And everything we have has been given to us from you. Thank you for so graciously providing us with so many good gifts, life, breath, everything that we enjoy. We acknowledge that all we have is yours and our hands are open. Teach us how to better steward everything you've entrusted to us, our financial resources, our time, our talents. Lord, to use all of our lives as a living sacrifice for your purposes and for your glory and for the good of our church family and the good of our community. May we together follow Christ Jesus, becoming more and more like Christ Jesus as we lead many, many more people, men and women, boys and girls, to faith in Christ Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. So if you will, open your Bible to Psalm 10. On the Lord's Supper Sundays, we go to the Psalms. We'll be back in James next week. Psalm chapter 10, or the 10th Psalm. Why do you hide yourself? Why do you hide yourself? Listen to the Word of God. Why, O Lord, why do you stand so far away? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? In arrogance, the wicked hotly pursue the poor. Let them be caught in the schemes that they have devised. For the wicked boast of the desires of his soul, and the one greedy for gain curses and renounces the Lord. In the pride of his face, the wicked does not seek him. All his thoughts are, "There is no God. His ways prosper at all times. Your judgments are on high, out of his sight. As for all his foes, he puffs at them. He says in his heart, 'I shall not be moved. Throughout all generations, I shall not meet adversity.' His mouth is filled with cursing and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue are mischief and iniquity. He sits in an ambush in the village. In a hiding place, he murders the innocent. His eyes stealthily watch for the helpless. He lurks in ambush like a lion in the thicket. He lurks that he may seize the poor. He seizes the poor when he draws him into his net. The helpless are crushed, sink down, and fall by his might. He says in his heart, 'God has forgotten. God has hidden his face. God will never see it.'" Verse 12, "Arise, O Lord. O God, lift up your hand. Forget not the afflicted. Why does the wicked renounce God and say in his heart, 'You shall not call to account?' But you do see, for you know mischief and vexation, that you may take it into your hands. To you the helpless commits himself. You have been the helper of the fatherless. Break the arm of the wicked and evildoer. Call his wickedness to account till you find none. The Lord is king forever and ever. The nations perish from his land. O Lord, you hear the desire of the afflicted. You will strengthen their heart. You will incline your ear to do justice to the fatherless and the oppressed, so that man who is of the earth may strike terror no more. This is the word of God. Let's pray. Father, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God, it stands forever. And by your grace, this word will do its work in our hearts this morning. It will lead us to not just continually focus on ourselves, but to open our eyes and see each other, see our neighbors, listen and hear the hurt, the injustice, the pain that so many around us experience, and to take responsibility as your priest. Every one of us are your priest. To pray for those who hurt and are hurt, call for your justice to come upon the earth. Lord, that we would take seriously our responsibility to pray for our church family and for our neighbors, to know, to care, to heal hurts, meet needs, all in the name of Jesus. Make us such a people. Amen. When was the first time you felt that knife edge of someone's malice against you? Someone hated you. I was about sixth grade. We had moved to a new town, and I was a pretty naive, sheltered kid, I think. And my next door neighbor, today they would call him a bully. Back then we just called it life. And he was like a brown belt in karate, and he just decided to try to break my neck every day after school. I would have bruises on my chest, bruises on my eye, on my face, just beat the mess out of me, kind of like Texas did Alabama last night, if you know what I mean. Dan, repent now, wherever you are. You remember that? The first time, I don't mean somebody hurt your feelings, I mean they hurt you. They came after you. Watch the news just a few minutes of the news. There's no shortage of injustice in our community. I don't know if it's still going on, but like 2 weeks ago, every time you drove to Hampton, somebody was shooting at you. It was crazy. Ukraine, all around the world. Psalm 10 has been there, it walks with you. It speaks about suffering and injustice at the hands of others. Psalm 10 models, it provides a pattern for praying, for you to speak to God about what you experience, for you to speak to God together, for you to speak to God for others, praying together for others about the brokenness of the world in our lives, that it leads us to turn, to complain, to ask, and to trust our God and our King, to turn to the Lord. Look at verse 1. Why, O Lord, do you stand far away? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? Where are you, God? It's a blunt question. It's a hard question. And I don't think he questions God's goodness or our power here. When you begin to question God's goodness, you quit going to God for help. Why? Because you don't seek the help of someone you've come to doubt. The act of asking why expresses faith, even as it asks a hard question. It's like last week, we talked about believing doubt. God, I trust you, but why do you stand so far off? God, I trust you, but why are you not paying attention in times of trouble? There's a story in the Gospel of Mark. This father seeks Jesus for mercy and help. His son has an unclean spirit, an impure spirit, who throws the son down in seizures and tries to harm him and tries to hurt him, and no one has been able to free this son. And the father comes to Jesus, and Jesus is teaching about faith, and the father says, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. One pastor said, it's the best any of us can really do, but thank God it's enough. Lord, I believe, but why? Lord, I believe, but where are you? And if you are a Christian, you do believe, but there are times when you can say, all you can say is, help my unbelief. Where are you? How long? Why, Lord? The questions of the Psalms. You hurt because of what someone has said about you, what someone has done to you. You hurt because of the sight of evil carried out against someone you love, someone you know. You hurt because of the sight of evil carried out against fellow human beings. We are miles away from the Ukraine. We actually have some members who know people in the Ukraine. We've done ministry in the Ukraine. But for most of us, they're pictures on TV. And yet, we hurt at the injustice that has been done. Becoming more and more like Jesus, you see the brokenness of the world around you. And sometimes it drives you to ask Jesus, why? Where are you? Why haven't you returned? I believe, but even in my belief, I can't believe this is happening. You're kind of stuck between the rock and a hard place. The rock, God is your rock. He is your refuge. He is your, but your experience of sin and evil and hurt in the world, it shakes. And so you're stuck between your belief. You know God exists. You know that He loves you. You know that He is good. You know that He's just. But there's your struggle. I can't believe this is happening. And under all this, for those with true faith, is the object of our belief, God Himself. I say true faith because God wants you to know that faith is not a good feeling. Faith is not wishful optimism. Biblical faith, the faith, the kind of faith that Jesus calls you and I to express, is acknowledging the truth of everything God's revealed in His Word, that He is just, that He is sovereign, that He is paying attention, and trusting Him. True faith, trust in God. It has personal confidence in God's goodness and ability, God's goodness, His love, His ability to bring justice. True faith believes that He has the power and the willingness to meet you in your need. So no matter how difficult things get, how dark the night, how hurt, how broken the person, how unjust the situation, how big the need, you can look to God and you can pray, help my unbelief. You can look to God and ask why. You can look to God and ask, where are you? How long? You can look to God and ask hard and blunt questions. Lord, help me see that you are paying attention. It may feel like an admission of guilt, like a statement of failure, or unbelieving doubt, especially if you grew up in church. But here's what's remarkable about this prayer. To pray it at all is to announce, I believe. Why, O Lord? Even in asking, you are turning to the Lord, not away from Him. We can't pray this prayer unless we do believe. If you've cried out to God, help my unbelief. If you called out, if you turned to God and asked why, then you've spoken from a place of belief. That's evidence of your faith. You may not feel it, but your words, your actions are showing it, expressing faith. So turn to the Lord, ask your questions, ask in faith, and complain. Now I know this is dangerous, telling a bunch of Baptists to complain. So listen to the rest of what I have to say, please. Complain. Speak to God about what has been done to you. Speak to God about the injustice, the evil you see happening to others. Complain. Look at verse 2. In arrogance, listen to what David, and we think David wrote this. Listen to what David says here. In arrogance, the wicked hotly pursue the poor. Let them be caught in the schemes that they have devised. For the wicked boast of his of the desires of his soul, and the one greedy for gain curses and renounces the Lord. What that probably says is they bless those who are greedy for gain and renounce the Lord. In their pride, the wicked does not seek God. All his thoughts are, there is no God. Now, these are not atheists in the sense that we think of it. This is the ancient world. They believe in a God. It's just God doesn't care. God doesn't matter. God's not involved. He's not going to do anything. His ways, the wicked, his ways prosper at all times. Your judgments are on high, out of his sight. He's not paying attention to God's decisions. God, what God says is good, what God says is true, what God says is beautiful. As for his foes, he puffs at them. He says in his heart, I won't be moved. I'm secure. I'll live forever without any adversity. His mouth is filled with curses and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue are mischief and iniquity. He sits in ambush in the villages. He's hiding to murder the innocent. His eyes stealthily watch for the helpless. He lurks like a lion in the thicket. And when he sees the opportunity, he seizes the poor in his mouth. He draws them into his net, and they are crushed. They sink down. They fall because he's so strong. And he says in his heart, God's forgotten. God's hidden in his face. God will never see this. David complains that the wicked persons seem to prosper and cause great harm. He speaks to God about the pride of the wicked, the plans of the wicked, and it's unthinkable, unbearable, unbelievable that God would allow such schemes to succeed. Why doesn't God do something with the people who proudly mock him? Why does God not do something with these people who live lives of deceit, who live lives of oppression and injustice? Why does it seem like the bad guys are always winning? A few years ago, I was reading Colston Whitehead's The Underground Railroad. Now, it's fiction, historical fiction, but the injustices committed, it evoked feelings of righteous anger or frustration of questions. I could only read a few pages at a time. This is so wrong. This is not right. That why would anyone treat human beings made in the image of God this way? It just evoked anger. Here we find the psalmist distraught at the victimization of the helpless. And this cruelty seems to come not at the hand of foreign nations, but at the hands of fellow Israelites. This is Americans killing Americans, in other words. Not that America has anything to do with Israel, but that's a different sermon. This is fellow Israelites, people who say they believe in God. But verse 3, they renounce the Lord as God. They despise the Lord. It's a way that the Old Testament, this is the language the Old Testament describes the faithless of God's own people. So this is not them, they. This is us. Is what David. Today, if we were to jump ahead 2,000 years and let God's word shine its light into our lives, today this points to men and women who identify with Christ in the church, use the term Christian, religious, spiritual to describe themselves, but simply refuse to imagine that God would stop them or judge them for how they live their lives. They identify with Christ in the church, but they take pride in their evil desires. They praise the guilty. They curse the Lord. If you're reading along verses 2 through 11, they bless what the Lord has cursed. That is, God has made these judgments, these decisions of this is good, this is evil, this is right, this is wrong. And there are actions that God has made clear he will judge. But these so-called Christians say these attitudes, these actions are blessed and good and beautiful and acceptable. Now, that would certainly apply to sexual sins. And some of y'all just want me to rant and rave at this point. But we've gotten enough bad Google reviews, so we'll move on. No, seriously. You want me to rant and rave against they and them? Let God's word speak to you. Psalm 10 is much more focused on pride, greed, the way we relate to and care for the poor, the vulnerable. Psalm 10 is very much focused on the way we make money and how we conduct our business. You know, the two things that I'm not supposed to talk to you about. So, verse 3, in the same way that the righteous person speaks well of the Lord and the righteous person speaks well of people who act like the Lord, so the wicked person speaks well. She uses her words to bless those who engage in extortionary practices in an effort to achieve dishonest gain and control other people and manipulate other people. They bless what the Lord has cursed. And this really points to the heart of what's wrong with all of us as sinners. We desire the wrong things. We praise the wrong things. We bless the wrong things when we should desire, praise, and bless the Lord. We should be speaking well of the Lord who created us and gave us all things and enjoying his good creation. But instead, Psalm 10 points to the height of our arrogance. We have such high opinions of ourselves that we do not seek the Lord. So, but we're here seeking the Lord this morning. Yes, we seek the Lord on Sunday morning, but do you seek the Lord Sunday afternoon through next Sunday morning about 9 o'clock. They don't seek the Lord. They don't need the Lord. My ways are right. My desires are right. My thoughts are right. My choices are right. So right that God won't hold me accountable. God doesn't care. I'm secure. I'll never be shaken. I'll never be shaken because I'll never meet a problem I can't fix myself. And you don't have to be rich to think this way. You could be young. You could be healthy. You could have some authority. And such pride leads to plans to use. Such pride in the psalm, it leads to plans to use others, hurt others. Do whatever you want to others as long as you get what you want. So meditate on it. Look at 7 through 11. Lie, use foul language, curse, scream and yell, whatever it takes to control people, high school football coach from the 1990s. Attack with threats, or use promises to exploit and abuse people. See people in need, that's a person that can be exploited. You see a person who can't defend themselves, that's a person you can control and get what you want. The sight of such evil carried out against fellow human beings, it can easily read, you become cynical. You just, emotionally, you're done. That's why I can't watch the news anymore. How do you persevere in the face of such horrors done to your neighbors, to your family? So everything in us screams out for justice. David feels this way, so he turns to the Lord. He complains about what he sees. He doesn't complain in general. He is specific. He speaks to God about what such wicked people say and do and prosper. He's not silent and he's not passive as he asks God to do something. Look at verse 12. Arise, O Lord. Get up, Lord. Lift up your hand. Flex your muscles. Forget not the afflicted. Remember, call them to mind. Why do the wicked renounce God and say in his heart, you will not call into account? Because you do see, Lord, you do note the mischief and the vexation that you may take it into your hands. To you, the helpless commits himself. You have been born the helper of the fatherless. You have been the helper of the fatherless. So God, break the arm of the wicked and evildoer. Call his wickedness to account. till you find none. Wipe out injustice from the face of the earth, Lord. Ask God to do something. This prayer is not passive complaining from the sidelines. This is not someone sitting in their rocking chair all week telling everybody else how to run the world. It's not wishful thoughts. It's not empty prayers. David takes an active stance as he asks God to defend the defenseless and the afflicted. David uses his words to speak to God about the specific injustice he sees, and he asks God to bring justice. So if we had time, we would go through this reading very closely. Verses 12 through 15 repeat many of the words from verses 2 through 11. So mischief, forget, see, renounce, helpless, wicked, this language is repeated, and this repetition emphasizes how God's action, what David is asking God to do, is a direct answer to the injustice of the wicked. In other words, David has complained specifically, and now he asks specifically for God to bring justice. And so verses 12 through 15 call God to shake the sense of security and independence expressed by the wicked. Verse 4 and 6 and 11, they think they can harm other persons without impunity. With impunity. There's no God who will hold me accountable. There's nothing bad will ever happen to us. We will be free from trouble forever. God isn't watching. He shut his eyes. He won't even see what we do. So David asks God to call them to account for their wicked deeds. Prove to everyone that you are the living and true God who judges the whole earth. Verse 15 is it's as strong as verse 1 is blunt. Break the arm of the wicked. This isn't literally God sends a muscle and break their bones. The arm is an image used often that symbolizes power and strength. The arm, it is the source of power. It's the source of strength. That's why I wear long sleeve shirts for y'all on Sunday mornings, not to intimidate you. We all know that. What David is saying is, God, break their power, break their strength, the means they use to hurt and use and abuse others. God, render them powerless, unable to carry out these wicked schemes. So he's saying, God, you do see, you judge good and evil, you do act, so bring final justice. That last verse there, verse 15, you know, until there's no more evil to be found, until there's no more injustice to be found, bring final justice as you call their wickedness to account. So we turn to God. We complain about the specific situation. We ask God to do something about the specific injustice. You see, you feel, you experience. And we trust. Look at verse 16. The Lord is king forever and ever, that the nations perish from his land. The Lord is king forever and ever. Unbelievers perish from his land, from his kingdom. Oh Lord, you hear the desire of the afflicted. You will strengthen their heart. You will incline your ear to do justice to the fatherless and to the oppressed, so that man who is of the earth may strike terror no more. We trust. Place your confidence in God's justice and power. God is king forever, verse 16. Now, David's original, the original readers of the psalm, right away, the light bulb's going off, because they see here Exodus 15, which is a psalm that celebrates God's deliverance of Israel through the Red Sea. It reminds them that God is the king who reigns, that God does hear their cries for salvation and freedom from slavery, and that God does bring salvation. These same words, the Lord is king forever, should remind us that right now our king has risen from the dead on the third day, and he is seated at the right hand of God the Father, ruling his kingdom and interceding for us until he returns to judge and renew the whole earth. And so we can have personal confidence that the Lord will do justice to the fatherless, the oppressed, the poor, the needy, the hurting, the used, the abused. That God will one day right all wrongs. He will straighten out all that is bent. He will rinse the world clean of all injustice. And how do we know this? Because in the middle of human history, God proved the lengths to which he was willing to go to undo injustice. He sent his own son, the one man who was ever truly just, to go to a cross and swallow all the injustice of all those who would simply trust in him. So God's agenda is to transfer us from the power of darkness and oppression into Christ's kingdom, and to transform us into the image of Christ, to transform us to be like Christ. And this helps us understand. This helps us understand why. Why, O Lord, do you stand far away? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? Why do you wait to bring final justice, complete judgment? God waits. God is patient. God, his justice is delayed because God is kind. Romans chapter 2 says, do you presume on the riches of God's kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? 2 Peter picks up on this. God's delay is not a sign of indifference or helplessness, but kindness, his desire that none of us should perish in judgment, but that all of us should come to repentance. God's patience and God's kindness, God's restraint to judge quickly provides an extended opportunity for the wicked, even the most wicked person, whether your boss is like Mr. Smithers or like Adolf Hitler level, the wicked. It is an opportunity for the most wicked person to turn from your sin and wickedness to trust in God's mercy and salvation. Romans continues, but because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. God will render to each one according to his works. See, God's kindness does not mean God will not hold you accountable for what you've done. In fact, you will answer to God for everything you've done. God will judge the whole earth. But God is delaying judgment so that the cup of the wicked might be overflowing, so that there might be no question about the justice of their punishment when it finally comes. See, God does not want you to think that he's powerless or clueless toward the way we use and manipulate and hurt other people. God wants you to know that he is kind and he is giving you the opportunity right here, right now, to turn from your sin, to trust and follow Jesus as King. But will you admit your arrogance, your pride, your greed, the way you use and manipulate and control people? Will you accept God's forgiveness and mercy given to you through faith in Jesus? And will you go from this place and act like a person who has received the mercy, the kindness, the patience of Jesus? See, Christian, God is working to transfer us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his Son. He is working right here, right now, to transform you and me into the image of his Son. He's working to transform us to be like our new King in all of his justice, kindness, and patience. We pay attention to the injustice and hurt around us and speak to the King about. We speak to the King to bring final justice. We love each other as a church family, and we love our neighbors by entering into each other's hurt and suffering, listening, paying attention so that we know one another well enough to turn to the Lord, to complain about the injustice, the hurt, the brokenness, asking Him to do something about this specific situation and trusting God as judge and king over all His creation. And so we pay attention and we speak to the King to bring justice. We work hard to reflect His justice, His kindness, His patience in our own character and actions. We steward our God-given power and privilege and resources to help heal the hurts and meet the needs in the community around us in the name of our King. We offer forgiveness to those who harm us. We extend mercy and kindness to the worst of us. And we share the good news about Jesus with confidence that God desires this wicked person's salvation. We are able to forgive, we're able to show mercy and kindness as we entrust all judgment and vengeance to our God, because every wrong deed, every injustice in all the universe will either be covered by the blood of Christ on the cross or repaid justly by God at the final justice, judgment. Until then, we turn to the Lord. We complain about the brokenness and injustice we experience in the world around us. We ask God to do something, and we trust our King and our Savior for justice. Let's pray. Father, do your work of transforming us into the image of our King, which means not just love, kindness, but justice, mercy, truth. Lead us, open our eyes to see, open our ears to hear, so that we can turn to you, we can speak to you, we can ask you to work your salvation and justice in the world, and we can trust you as we await the day that Jesus returns to judge and renew the whole earth. Make us this sort of people. In your name I pray, amen. This morning we're going to close our time of worship with a song. If you need prayer, if you want to know more about following Jesus, if you need to confess and turn to Jesus for salvation, I'd love to pray with you. I'll be in the back. Feel free to come back, or after the service, I'll be around. Let's stand and let's sing as we worship.
Seated. The ushers are going to come forward, and if you'll pray with me for the offering this morning. Let's pray. Gracious God, you have been so kind to us, Lord. In all of our sin and all of our rebellion, Lord, you've sent Jesus to save us and to give us an opportunity to be a part of your kingdom. And we come to you this morning, Lord, and ask you to bless these gifts. Help us to be good stewards of our time, our talent, Lord, and our treasure. Help us to give with cheerful hearts this morning. For your son's sake, we pray. Amen.
As the ushers take up the offering, just a few announcements. Reminder, tonight at 5 o'clock in the cafe is our quarterly members meeting. And this Wednesday starts our discipleship and community groups and classes. They start at 6:15. Pastor will be leading a biblical worldview study. Now, this study will help give us look at our world through a Christian lens by getting to the fundamentals of what God created and why. So that group will be meeting in the classrooms right back here across the hall from the worship center. We also have our Restore group that meets on Wednesday nights. This group is about gospel restoration. So if there is anything in your life that has taken a stronghold, this could be substance addictions, it could be anger, anxiety, depression, anything that has become a habitual habit, this group comes alongside each other, equipped with God's word, to point each other back to Christ, in whom we find true restoration. The third group that's going to be meeting on Wednesday nights is our new Moms of Bayside. This group is a group of moms, whether your kids are preschool through high school, we come together to connect with each other. We connect to Christ in studying and discussing God's word together. And then we connect with our families by taking what we've learned in our group time and applying it at home. So we invite you to be a part of that. If you have any questions about these groups, want to find a group that is a good fit for you, I'll be in the Welcome Center. Feel free to stop by. I'll be happy to talk with you. Don't forget to RSVP for the dinner. That is at 5:15. We serve from 5:15 to 6, so you can come at any time in there. You can RSVP at the Welcome Center. Links on emails, Facebook, website, all that. You can find it anywhere. But early RSVPs helps our kitchen ministry team be prepared, so please remember to do that. And I will turn it back to Lauren, who will close our service out.
If y'all would rise for the benediction. Our benediction today comes from Ephesians 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Have a blessed week, church.